Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Reborn to Master the Blade, From Hero King to Extraordinary Squire, Volume 2, by Hayaken. Translated by Mike Langweiser. Narrated by Michelle H. Lee. Chapter 1. Inglis, age 15. The Chiral Knights Academy, 1. The day of the Chiral Knights Academy entrance ceremony had arrived at last. An attractive young blonde man, slightly older than Raphael and wearing a grandiose outfit with a flowing cape, delivered a rousing speech to the assembled incoming students. This was Raphael's commander, Prince Wayne.
And with Highland supplying fly gears, both the operational deployment and the tactical application of knights will be revolutionized. Your class will be at the forefront. Pioneers in a new era of warfare.
The female students stood transfixed by his dashing figure, but Prince Wayne had more going on for him than just his looks. As the man who'd suggested airlifting the frozen prismer, his mind was surely as impressive as his body. The Knights Academy offered a 3-year training program, with exceptionally promising cadets allowed to skip years. The majority of students were young aristocrats or relatives of knights. There was the occasional gifted commoner, most of whom were blessed with a particularly valued rune that had attracted some sort of patronage. And Inglis had heard rumors of a few exchange students in her class. Rafinha sighed.
Ah, Prince Wayne's so dreamy.
Come on, Ronnie. You're here to study. Stay focused, Inglis scolded.
Can't a girl at least dream?
Nope. You're way too young for that anyway. Not happening.
Okay, Mom. You know, Chris, you don't get on my nerves very often, but...
Leone tried to diffuse the tension.
Now, he definitely is quite the specimen. Don't you think so, Inglis?
Not really.
So, who do you prefer then?
Well, that's an awkward question when I'm not even interested in men. Probably that prismer from before. It seemed pretty strong.
Why, that's not even human. I don't understand how you can be so beautiful and yet not have any interest in romance.
Yet here I am, having exactly none.
What a waste. If I looked like you, I'd have more boyfriends than I could keep track of.
Rafinha piled on.
I can see a ton of guys asking for Inglis's hand. She acts so grown up, after all.
No.
Why are you even going there, Ronnie? You really do act like you're my mother sometimes.
As the trio bickered among themselves, Prince Wayne finished his speech.
And, of course, there are also times when squires must take the lead.
Now the teacher acting as master of ceremonies took the stage.
His Royal Highness will now present the Academy emblem to each student. Please walk to the podium as your name is called.
Prince Wayne had a few words for each student as they received their emblem, and their eyes tended to sparkle at the honor. It seemed he was a natural leader to boot.
Rafinha Bilford.
Rafinha made her way to the podium as her name was called. It was well known that she was the sister of the holy knight Raphael, and the assembly buzzed with excitement as she passed by.
So she's Raphael's little sister? She's cute?
And she has an upper-class rune too, right? What a family.
If I make friends with her, I might get to meet Raphael.
Prince Wayne watched as she approached and spoke as she arrived.
Hey, so you're Raphael's sister? You look just like him. He's definitely a man I'm glad to have on my side.
And I'm sure he's equally glad to have a commander like you.
A sister of Raphael's is a sister of mine. If you're ever in any trouble, just ask. I'll do whatever I can.
Thank you.
It seems the other students also know your family. Don't let the pressure hold you back. I'm sure that's what Raphael would want as well.
Of course.
Next to walk the stage.
Inglis Eucas.
Inglis's walk produced its own distinctly flavored buzz.
Wow, I've never seen anyone so beautiful.
She is, but she doesn't have a rune. Is she a squire then? With looks like that, she'd have no problem living a comfortable life. I wonder why she chose to enlist instead.
Inglis curtsied as she arrived before Prince Wayne.
And you must be Rafinha's cousin.
Yes, sir.
A strong squire corps is the future of warfare. Even if you don't have a rune, your exploits will open the path for others. In many ways, the future is in your hands. Stand tall and take good care of Rafinha. We both know day-to-day leadership comes from the ranks, right?
It was clear that even Inglis, as someone without a rune, would be held to a high standard. It was fairly typical for nobles to send trusted commoners to be trained as squires, especially now as flygear pilots. Of course, I'll do my utmost. Some time passed after Inglis's entrance, as other students walked across the stage. Then came the call. Leone Olfa. Another buzz of yet another kind. Hey, wait a minute. Olfa? Like, that traitor Leone's sister? I can't believe she'd show her face here. As Leone walked over, Prince Wayne spoke to her.
I'm sorry, Leone. We are, in part, responsible for the voices you hear now. Unable to give word to the misdeeds of a Highlander.
No, if anyone must apologize, it is myself. I swear, one day I will capture my brother and restore honor to the Olfa name.
Well, you're not Leone. You're you. I believe in you, and I know a bright future awaits. Press forth. Ignore the murmurs of doubt.
I will. Soon the entrance ceremony was over, and orientation began. Eventually, the students would be divided between squires and knights, but for now, they were all gathered in one mass on the fields of the academy. There stood a massive stone sparring ring, and within it, a young woman stood, her back straight, grasping an artifact in the form of a staff. She was attractive, with flaxen hair and wearing a long flowing robe with cute decorations. Glasses with small round lenses and a perpetual grin completed her look.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm your principal, Mariella. I'm so happy to meet you all.
Mariella had, for some reason, not been at the podium during the entrance ceremony. She seemed young for her role, and she gave off a relaxed and casual demeanor. But from her hand glimmered a special class rune, proof that she was a holy knight, and that she was far more than she let on. She beamed down at the students.
Let's skip the formalities and get right down to the orientation, shall we? First, I'll explain what you'll be studying here. How about a quick warm-up? Everyone, come right into the ring. Oh, but you budding young knights with an artifact, be sure to leave those behind.
I'm down for this. Sounds fun. Inglis leaped into the ring and...
thump.
What?
Her body felt like it was made of lead, and she unexpectedly stumbled as she landed.
So heavy.
I can't stand.
I can't even move. As she looked around, she saw her fellow students crumple to their knees, unable to move.
And that's a gravity field created by my artifact. It's how we conduct training at the academy. So grin and bear it. I don't want to see a single one of my kids fall on the battlefield, so I'm going to get you into tip-top shape.
Most of the students were having second thoughts now, but not Inglis. Just feeling the mana flowing around her to weigh her down was a wonderful sensation. So this is the power of Mariella's artifact. Figuring out how to apply that herself, to herself, would be like killing two birds with one stone, both physical training and mana manipulation training.
This is amazing. I already love this school. I can't wait to learn how to do that.
Inglis was already lost in daydreams about how and where the mana twisted around her.
Eek! It's so heavy!
Rafinha was still on 2 feet, but only barely.
This'll be tough without an artifact,
Leone said, holding up a bit better.
But it'll be a good challenge.
Inglis nodded.
Yeah, I think this kind of training is a great idea. But if we have to do this all the time, my thighs are going to get even bigger.
Leone seemed to have a bit of a complex about what training with a greatsword had done to her figure.
All right, here they come.
Mariella snapped her fingers, and humanoid figures rose up from a hole in the ring. Rock golems? Inglis's brow furrowed. Is this part of her artifact's power, or does she have another? I don't know, but it must take a lot of power to create a giant like that. If she's able to use two artifact gifts at once, she's definitely got a special class rune. I'd love to see what she's capable of someday. Maybe I can see that now.
All right, class. It's a game of tag, and these three rock golems are it. Anyone left in the ring after 10 minutes gets free meals in the cafeteria for a month. Do your best, and don't get caught.
That was a mouth-watering announcement indeed.
Oh, that'll be great to have.
I can't let myself get caught, but it's so heavy. To Inglis and Rafinha, with their voracious appetites, the prize was worth even more. Don't worry, Ronnie. There's only three, so... So you can't get caught by a golem if you've turned it into gravel.
And... Go! Principal Mariella announced.
Ha! As soon as the time began, Inglis launched into a high kick at the nearest golem. The impact sent it sprawling back out of the ring, where it shattered.
Hmm?
The principal gasped in surprise.
Yeah! Gotcha!
A punch, then a throw, sent the other two golems following. Inglis's body may have been weighed down, but that didn't mean she was helpless. If anything, it was just the amount of weight she wanted to train under.
All right!
A whole month of eating whatever I want without worrying about the price? Rafinha grinned.
You did it! Now it's all we can eat for a month!
Leone nodded.
Amazing, Inglis. Though I shouldn't be amazed.
While Rafinha and Leone celebrated, the other students looked on, awestruck.
If no one's left to be it,
then we're all safe? All right!
We eat free for a month.
The thought of free food for each and every student for a month sent a cold sweat down Mariella's back. She nervously stammered out an excuse.
And yes, of course, if all three golems are thrown out of the ring, you're safe. Thank you for the demonstration.
But Principal, that's no fair.
Inglis groaned.
Sorry. I made a mistake. Let's try this one more time.
I guess I shouldn't be surprised that she's so shocked. Just have to take him down again. And it is good training.
That's funny. I must have slipped up somewhere. But that never happens, right?
Mariella shook her head as she talked to herself, then raised the golems again.
Now, for real this time. Go!
Huh?
Thud, thud, thud. Three palm strikes, three downed golems. Principal Mariella, momentarily speechless, forced a grin.
Hee hee. Oh my, of course. That was still just a demonstration. We need to go over the important part at least twice, right?
But Principal, that's really not...
Shh! Mariella rushed up to Inglis and whispered to her furtively.
Listen, we can negotiate. 3 months for you, as long as you don't really give him the boot until the end. I'll even overlook it if you happen to maneuver out of bounds for a second.
A month for three people each, and it's a deal.
I knew we could come to an agreement.
Oh, but could you make the load on me heavier?
A further reduction of maneuverability would be even better training for Inglis.
Well...
Mariella paused hesitantly.
I kind of cast it on everyone, so I can't really adjust it on a person-by-person basis. If you really want that, you can stay after class for extra lessons, but...
I'd love to.
Mariella paused again before confirming. How about 2 months for three, then?
Got it.
They had reached a deal, and getting a good close look at the mana causing this enhanced gravity just might let Inglis use it herself. That, she resolved, would be her first goal at the academy.
Okay, this time for real.
Three more rock golems sprang up, chasing the students around the ring. Slowed by the gravity, they were thrown out of the ring one by one. Time seemed to pass in a flash.
Only 90 seconds left. The six of you still in the ring, do your best. Mirella cheered her students on. Of the six remaining, three were Inglis, Rafinha, and Leona. The rock golems were completely ignoring Inglis, and she in turn only watched the melee unfold around her, paying close attention to the other three students. Two seemed to be future knights, and the third here to train as a squire. An unexpectedly good performance from the squires altogether. Her attention first shifted to the two who had paired up, a boy squire and a girl knight.
"Come on, Pullum! You may be slow, but you can hide behind me," the boy said.
"Okay, Lottie, but will you be all right? Your legs are trembling."
"Don't worry about that. I'll be fine."
"Here it comes! Go over there!"
"Ah, don't shove me! You keep getting in the way!"
"Tee, sorry!"
The knight, Pullum, and the squire, Lottie, certainly made quite a scene. But the shove was enough to get him out of the way of the golem's swing. Pullum, huh? I bet she knows exactly what she's doing there. There's definitely more to her than she lets on.
"Come then, golems. I, Lieselotte Arcia, shall not fall as easily as you hope,"
came the voice of a trainee knight. She was an aristocrat, even in her speech. Her wavy blonde hair certainly looked the part of a proper young lady. She was good-looking, but seemed somewhat unapproachable. Up until now, she'd been surrounded by a guard of students, attendants, maybe. But they'd already been knocked out. Inglis had, at first, wondered whether Lieselotte was capable of much on her own. But she did seem to be competent, standing at the edge of the ring and waiting for her chance to knock out a golem. More than just a famous name, then, Inglis thought.
60 seconds left! This is the final stretch! Oh, and I'm turning the gravity up!
Inglis could almost hear the thunk of another weight being added.
"Ah, that feels great!"
Inglis may have been happy, but Rafinha let out a groan of dismay.
"I can't do this anymore! Ugh, I can't move!"
If Rafinha and Leona had their artifacts, things may have turned out differently, but the increased gravity was too much for them to bear.
"Eek! Whoa!"
They were each caught by a golem and flung from the ring.
"And we're down to the final four!"
Gravity also took its toll on the other three with Inglis, and they were caught one by one.
"Gah!"
Lottie groaned.
"Are you okay, Lottie? Eek!"
Pullum screeched.
"This weight, it's killing me! Help!"
The only salvation for Lottie was being pulled out from under Pullum as the golems cast them from the ring.
"Accursed beasts, lay not a finger on me!"
Lieselotte struggled, but was helpless once caught.
"And we're down to one."
That one being Inglis. The crowd murmured, all eyes on Inglis.
"Huh, there's that cadet.
I figured she'd be the last. So maybe the principal didn't make a mistake earlier."
But what they noticed most was something else about her.
"She's beautiful," they all exclaimed.
Boys and girls alike were entranced. Objectively, Inglis understood the reaction. Pleasing Rafinha and her close friends was fine, and she still enjoyed looking at herself in a mirror. But being the center of public attention wasn't her thing. Even in her past life, the adulation of her retainers and subjects had been a different kind of gaze, at least. It was time to finish this, and when she looked over at Mirella, she received a nod.
"Go time, then."
Inglis stepped forward, directly between the three golems, and they fell on her as one.
"Ha!"
She leaped straight into the air to avoid their charge, easily over the golems' heads, even through the increased gravity that kept her classmates from even standing. It was a heavy weight, but one that felt almost reassuring. The golems crashed together and began to struggle against each other with sight of their target lost. And then Inglis dropped back in.
"This is over!"
Her supple legs arced forward, sending all three golems flying in one blow. Almost unbelievably, they went flying far, far away. After all, it wouldn't do to drop them on the watching students who gasped in awe.
Time's up. The meal ticket goes to Inglis. Now,
Next up is a test flight in a fly gear. Everyone, get ready to go to the fly gear dock.
Clap, clap, clap. Cheers and applause washed over Inglis as she stood alone in the ring. And as she did, Mariella rushed to her side.
Now, Principal Mariella, about before?
Of course, I'm still up for it. Just drop by my office anytime. But Inglis, are you sure you're not a Hyrule menace or something?
That would be absurd.
It would, wouldn't it? You don't really seem like one. Fascinating. There's so much I'd love to discuss with you.
The principal's eyes glimmered as she stared at Inglis.
Of course.
Something seemed a bit strange here, but all Inglis could do was nod. Soon after.
All right, class. Now let's go to the fly gear dock off campus. It's kind of what you'd call the highlight of the academy, so pay close attention.
As Principal Mariella spoke, seemingly timed deliberately, patches of a large shadow appeared around the class, accompanied by a low throbbing hum. It was a fly gear port. Its winged hull was dotted with 10 or so bays for fly gears to dock, which could in turn provide it with additional lift and thrust. Each fly gear could carry 3 or 4 people, making the full complement of a fly gear port 30 to 40. Essentially, it was a fly gear mothership. Currently, each of the fly gears held 1 flight instructor.
"Climb aboard," Mariella said. "It's a bit of a hike, so we'll be taking these."
The students clambered aboard the fly gear port, many enthused for their first flight aboard something that was still in limited deployment on a nationwide basis. Inglis had recently taken a fly gear port to the capital, so this would be her second flight, making her nearly as excited as they were. She loved flying. She loved the sensation, as well as the novelty of something that would have been considered unthinkable in her past life.
"Oh, the breeze feels so good. I love flying."
Rafinha was enjoying herself as well. Inglis shot her a grin. Currently, the fly gear port forms the backbone of the surface's air power, since the Highlanders still haven't parted with any of their flying battleships, Mariella explained.
"Do you think we'll be able to acquire any of those at some point?"
Leone asked. "Well, we'd sure like to, but it's not going to be easy. We had to go through long, drawn-out negotiations to get just these fly gears and fly gear ports. So it's best to perfect our use of these rather than hold out hope." The Highlanders would be in no hurry to supply weapons that surface dwellers could use against them. Each armament or piece of support equipment would no doubt be subject to a thorough export review. The fly gear port carrying the students proceeded across the skies, over the capital, toward a large nearby lake. Lake Bolt, connected by navigable rivers to the sea, was home to a sprawling harbor district. And this access to both shipping and abundant fisheries had played no small part in where the capital was located.
"Oh, and remember the way here from the academy. We're flying you out today, but for most of your training, you'll be moving by foot."
Surprised moans of, "But it's so far," arose from the students as the fly gear port glided down to a level part of the shore a distance from the harbor, set aside to limit the potential damage from accidents during fly gear training. A cadet who fell from their fly gear would also be far safer diving into the lake than if they'd lost control over solid ground. Since the academy had been a long-standing institution well before the introduction of fly gears, its distance from a suitable airstrip was inevitable. Stepping into the cavernous hangar, the students found a fly gear port fully loaded with fly gears waiting for them.
"Wow, this is amazing. Ah, it's so exciting."
"Wow, the capital really does have everything."
Mariella's voice projected over the awestruck new students. "A fly gear can hold 3 or 4 people, so group up into 3s and 4s and try them out. First, pull the ignition lever under the control column and detach the fly gear from the fly gear port." Inglis, Rafinha, and Leona grouped up and headed for a fly gear. With a quick pull of the ignition lever, the fly gear's engine sprung to life with a satisfying purr.
"Don't touch the controls yet. Just push the fly gear onto the runway. They float a little when they're idling, so it should be easy."
The principal's description held true. The fly gear, once started up and detached, hovered, swaying slightly off the ground. Inglis contemplated the device before her. It really doesn't take much, does it?
I love how it's so floaty, added Rafinha.
Leone nodded.
It really is.
They pushed it out onto the runway as they conversed. Once you're outside, climb on, Mariella continued. That meant they were cleared for taxi. Inglis was first aboard.
All right. Wow, it's a lot bumpier than the flygear port.
Rafinha followed her.
Huh, you're right. The flygear port's a lot bigger, so it's more stable, I guess, Leone said.
The other group seemed to be just as enthusiastic to get aboard.
All right, everyone. Let's take it easy at first, okay? One of you on each flygear, grip the control column. Everyone else, hold on tightly to the rails.
Inglis looked over at Rafinha and Leone.
Can I go first? Sure, Chris. You're the squire, after all. Do your best, Inglis. Okay, thanks.
Inglis gripped the yoke, the same excitement running down her spine as it did just before a fight.
Slowly ascend and head out over the lake. If you're unsure of the controls, there are reminders on the panel, so pay close attention. To get started, pull the yoke toward you while accelerating. The accelerator pedal is on the right, below the yoke.
Inglis looked down at the panel, its markings confirming Mariella's instructions. While familiarizing herself with the controls, she slowly drifted the flygear out over the water.
Ah, I can do this!
It was exhilarating, almost like the first time she'd ridden a horse. Rafinha squealed in excitement.
This feels great! You're right, Leone nodded. The view's beautiful too.
She was right. Seeing the beautiful blue of the lake stretching out below was a thrilling sight. Mariella continued her lecture.
Once you get used to it, you can try speeding up, but be light with the controls while steering. We wouldn't want you to crash now, would we?
Rafinha's eyes gleamed at the idea.
Chris, let's see how fast this thing can go. Are you sure we're supposed to?
Leone wasn't quite sure it was a good idea, but Rafinha's enthusiasm had infected Inglis.
Hold on tight, because here goes.
She stomped hard on the accelerator.
Vroom.
The flygear's engine roared as it rocketed off through the sky, the speed at which the terrain flew by below, the whistling wind pushing against her. It was unlike anything Inglis had ever experienced. She gasped.
Wow, this is pretty fast.
Rafinha was grinning.
Even faster than I thought. This feels so good.
Meanwhile, Leone protested.
Isn't this a bit too fast? It's pretty scary.
But we're going to be fighting magicite beasts with these, right? We'd better get used to it.
Inglis reasoned. Rafinha nodded.
Yep, it wouldn't do us much good just reading about it. You're probably right, but... Wait!
Leone stammered.
Wait, turn! There's a merchant ship right in front of us!
It's fine, we've got plenty of room. I'll just turn a little bit and... Inglis let off the accelerator for a moment while pulling the yoke to one side. But as she did, the ship in front of them pitched sharply to one side. And not from poor construction or navigation. They could see a gigantic shadow rising from below it, pushing its keel to the surface.
Whoa, it's gonna sink,
Rafinha yelled. Inglis pondered aloud.
Wait, is there something below it?
Leone gasped.
That's...
A massive maw rose from the waves and bit a chunk off the side of the ship.
A magicite beast?
The prism flow fell on lakes and seas as it did on dry land. The beasts dwelling in water were not immune to its effects. Leone and Rafinha noticed it immediately.
A fish magicite beast? Oh no, it's gonna eat them.
Then it's up to us to save them. We're going in,
Inglis said.
You're right. We're the closest ones here,
Rafinha nodded.
Got it.
Even Leone was in full agreement. Inglis held the throttle at full while descending to get in close, the flygear whipping the surface of the lake around as she rushed toward the beast. Rafinha clutched her bow.
All right, let's see what I can do.
Okay, Ronnie.
As they closed in on the ship, Rafinha leveled her favored artifact bow and fired off a shiny flow. An arrow of light cut toward the beast, only for it to, as if it noticed the attack coming, dive back below the surface. Rafinha's arrow, unable to pierce the water, faded into nothingness. Rafinha sighed.
Ah, it ran away into the water.
Inglis had a backup plan, though.
Leone, your sword can hit it down there.
Leave it to me.
Leone unsheathed her dark greatsword artifact and pointed it low toward the water.
Give me speed!
The blade tore through the surface of the lake, extending downward as it did, and soon hit the beast's shadow below the surface.
A direct hit!
Leone cheered. But no sooner had the words left her mouth than the fly gear rocked wildly as the beast's thrashing twisted the blade in her hands.
Ugh! It's so heavy!
Inglis looked back.
I'll help out. Ronnie, take the stick.
Okay, Chris. Thank you, Inglis.
Leave it to me.
Inglis wrapped her hands around the dark artifact's greatsword's grip, alongside Leona's clenched grasp.
Here we go. One, two, lift!
With their strength combined, they pulled the sword upward to lift the beast from the water.
Splash!
The Magicite beast was pulled to the surface, but the greatsword pulled free as well and swung high into the air.
Ah, it's getting away,
Leone cried.
Don't worry.
Inglis nimbly leaped from the fly gear and began running across the surface of the lake, water walking. Her daily practice was paying off.
This isn't that hard as long as I step lightly, she thought to herself.
What? You're running on water? What in the world is going on here? Well, that's Chris for you.
With commentary from a shocked Leone and a proud Rafinha, Inglis rushed across the surface of the lake to where the Magicite beast was trying to dive back to safety.
Ah!
A kick with all her might sent it aloft instead, and Inglis kicked again and again as it came back down.
Three, four, five hits!
Kick after kick propelled the beast to the shore.
Now someone finish it off!
Okay.
Principal Mariella was shocked, but she finished the job nonetheless. Afterward, she turned to the group and said,
I feel like I should be terrified by what I just saw, but well done.
You're right,
Inglis replied.
Fish Magicite beasts are terrifying. You can never tell where they're lurking.
That wasn't quite what I meant, but such is life. I guess I'm lucky to have.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.